Good evening to one and all, and thanks for joining us today as we go live with our session called Leading with Resilience, a Diagnosis. This is the 76th show, which is a part of a series brought to you by TLR Now. TLR Now, which is a niche in coaching, training, and mentoring service provider based out of Pune, India. They have chapters in Sri Lanka, Oman, Nepal, Bhutan, and they are expanding further. The best part is that the systems are all decked up with a growing network of more than 80 plus mentors across domains and locations. TLR Now is here to offer a confluence of what will help the individuals excel in their personal life as well as professional domains by enhancing life skills. TLR brings together subject experts and share insights on various aspects of life which have the potential to transform life through structured and meaningful ways. A little bit about myself. I am Dr. Preeti. I am a medico-turned-management professional, columnist, trainer, amateur painter, blogger based in Muscat, Oman, since about more than a year and a half now. And I'm currently exploring a lot of interests and entire gamut of interests and passions which interest me and searching for my life's own meaning. A little more than a year ago, the entire world was struck with a heavy blow known as COVID-19. Since last year, there have been unprecedented changes in our lives, the way we work, the way we communicate, and the way we relate. It has affected nearly everything in our lives, ranging from a small activity like purchasing grocery to working from home, working at home, and nowadays working from anywhere. Now, as most of us did have the luxury or the freedom or the liberty of working from the comfort of our homes, there is a set of people who did not have the freedom or liberty of working from their homes. Since last many months, their workplace itself has become their home. We respectfully call them as the frontline warriors. Perhaps the importance of these frontline warriors has never been felt and experienced as it has been done today. To sensitize us on what they have gone through, how they have led in the times of crisis, how they have worked together as a team, comfort us in the situation, today's session is about leading with resilience. Move the discussion forward. We have with us Dr. George Noel Fernandez. He is a medical graduate from St. John's Medical College and a postgraduate in preventive and social medicine, which we call as PSM, travel medicine from Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons, Scotland, emergency medicine and quality in healthcare practices from Boston. He is also an expert in disaster management. And he has held many leadership positions as CEO, COO, Vice President, and Medical Director for premium hospitals abroad like St. Mary's Hospital, Pennsylvania, Saudi German Hospital, Dubai, and also in India, like Apollo Hospitals and CK Birla Hospitals and more. With a global mindset and high energy, he is comfortable donning many hats, both as a clinician as well as an administrator. Brings with him a rich experience of more than 24 years on the field. I welcome Dr. George to the show. It is an honor for us to have you with us today, sir. A very good evening and welcome.
A very good evening, Preeti. Thank you for having me on this show. It's a pleasure.
Thank you so much, sir. I'll start with the basics, Dr. George. I'll straight away come to your background of education. How has a background in PSM, like which we call as preventive and social medicine, helped you in the present situation? Because I particularly remember when I was pursuing my dentistry and my medical counterparts used to talk about the post-graduation. PSM and preventive and social medicine used to be the last on the list. They used to think that, you know, you'll have to settle down with a PG in PSM, which was not seen as a very good thing in those days. It was like many years back. In fact, remember that PSM or preventive and social medicine, we call the full form as, we used to associate it with only immunization, polio vaccination drive, sanitation, or, you know, maybe the rural health, these kind of drives. But that time, I think none of us, at least I would admit that I never realized the importance of this subject would come so handy as an expertise, the reason for which we have you on the show. So how has this background of PSM actually helped you in the present situation, talking of the COVID-19? Sir.
Yes, Priti, I think so. I took up PSM because I was posted in a village called Mallur in Karnataka. And it was a great learning experience for me because what I saw there, that the people were not getting enough medical help. And we were basically trying to just deliver primary health care. And that itself was a huge challenge at that time. Now I'm talking of the late 90s at that time. This is... where even getting basic medicines in villages was very difficult. We yet had to penetrate, I mean, the healthcare yet had to penetrate the primary healthcare centers and in the rural areas. And that was something that really I took it up, and it was very interesting. It has been a very interesting journey. In the middle, I worked with Care India. I worked with UNICEF again during my early years. And every place was different because you always get posted in a kind of a remote area. Yeah. And everything was challenging. But also, I think so, over the years, what was more important was my learning experiences. It was just on the education. The education looked taught me where to see, but how to deal with the situation. I think so. That's where the experiences taught me, and I was very privileged that I learned small experiences. I was involved with the polio campaign in some countries, and a very basic thing like not being able to maintain the cold chain. The polio campaign did not work. So, I mean, when we thought about, yes, we engaged a lot of people, but a small thing like not being able to see that the polio vaccine arrived in the cold chain, and the whole campaign went berserk. So these are small, small learnings. And what has helped me in this particular situation, though in this situation has been quite different, because this is like a completely, we have been attacked, and it's like a rural setup. I mean, we have the best of places. I mean, I worked in the best of places, even in New York, or be it New Delhi, or be it any part of the world. When the pandemic, or the COVID struck us, we were just like any other place. It just reminded me of my rural posting, where we did not know what to do. So it has been a very interesting journey. Now, coming back to your question of, yes, how PSM helped us, particularly, I think so, in the vaccination campaign and trying to identify how to localize the disease, more importantly. So yes, if how to prevent community spread, that was one of the learnings that really we were able to pick out. And also vaccination to help us in the vaccination.
Yeah, that's really, I mean, that's what I was saying in the beginning, that we used to only associate it with the immunization and the vaccination and the polio. PSM used to be only polio drops and polio posting for us. But yes, it's a great insight from your end, because you've been through it throughout, and you've got a rich bio. I mean, the bio which was shared with me, it was told that it is a brief bio. But eventually, when I read it out to myself, I realized that the brief part is also quite rich in itself. And that's why, I mean, it's really a pleasure having you here. And it's quite inspiring to know that you have worked in various disaster areas, such as the Bali bomb blast, I read, earthquakes, tsunami, various coastal situations, SARS, SARS, which we called H1N1 pandemics, and other similar areas. And you've personally performed more than 500 medical air evacuations, as I have read in the bio. Has it been different this time during the COVID situation as compared to the scenes which I just now enumerated?
Yes, this has been very, very different. Like, I'll give you an example, the Bali bombing. It was just a particular area. It was a hotel that had a bomb blast, and it was just an area that we needed to contain. We could get help from outside. I was based out of Singapore at that time. We were able to drive in with our planes. We took in a Hercules aircraft where we could put in 18 stretchers. There were various governments that were ready to help us, and also a number of private institutions that were helping us. So the fund flow, the ability to help, the ability to get medical people on the ground as soon as possible. There was no restriction because there was just an area that we had to be looking at. Similarly, in the tsunami, even when the tsunami struck, though it struck over a wider range, India was affected, Sri Lanka, Indonesia, in all these areas, coastal areas were affected, but still, there was a time, I mean, maybe 3 hours or 4 hours after the tsunami, we could go inside and do the rescue job and we could pull in resources. Unfortunately, in the COVID-19, the whole world got affected. So what was happening? It compromised on the biggest resource, which is the human resource. The medical people were affected, all the people in the community were affected, the resources were limited, industries were affected, the vaccination, if you look at medicines, hospitals, everybody got compromised. So this was a totally different situation, which I do not think so. I mean, I've been writing pandemic and writing business continuity plans from 2004, once when terror and natural disasters became a routine. But nothing prepared us, to be honest, nothing prepared us to what we all have experienced in the past 1 year. Of where every country and every city, every town, every neighborhood was under the same threat, which whether it was a street in New York or again, as I said, a street in New Delhi or in any part of Japan, everybody experienced the same thing. So there was no way that we could pull in any further resources. All resources got compromised. It became, I have never seen something as drastic as this. We have never experienced anything like this. The complete medical community has not experienced this. So, I mean, yes, we have prepared for disasters. I have been down in Afghanistan where we have done a lot of rescue operations. But again, when in those particular areas, as I said, you might not be able to enter the area immediately, but you can get resources, you can pull in resources from all other places. But in this COVID-19 situation, we just got compromised ourselves. I mean, so we saw hospitals themselves had to close down. I mean, we didn't have a pandemic plan, or we didn't know how to really look after our own employees. Doctors felt sick, nursing staff felt sick, the paramedic doctors felt sick. So from where to get resources? We didn't know what the pandemic, what COVID-19 was going to bring. Yes, we went in with a very clear image of saying, yes, it is an infectious disease. But at a very early stage, we had not much of an idea about what is the distance that we should be away from, what is the protective gear we should be using, how should business continue, what should we do? I'll give you an example. I was working in a hospital in Mumbai, for example, and we were totally unprepared because we just had one common entrance. So we were getting normal patients and we were getting infectious patients through the same entrance. And hence, at some point, the complete hospital got compromised. And so we had the nursing staff falling sick. Now, how to run the hospital? We had doctors falling sick. How to run the hospital? So, and we could not pool in any resources from anywhere because it was the same story in every hospital across the world. So it has been a very challenging time. And I think so. It's been one of the biggest learning experiences for anybody who has been in disasters or in pandemic situations.
Yeah, very rightly said, Dr. George, that the assets, the human resources, which we call the assets, they themselves became liabilities for us. We were the carriers, we were the infection holders, and we became the problem for ourselves. And we have read, when everybody has witnessed, that even the most developed nations have fallen short of how to manage and how to go about the entire situations. I mean, the poor have been affected, the rich have been affected. There is no differentiation. Everybody has been affected equally. And talking about the leaders, you've been at many leadership positions throughout your career, Dr. George. You've seen a lot. Has the leadership situation changed in today's time? Like, for example, there are the basic ingredients which we call the more patience, more empathy, more understanding. I mean, they're already there. Already the desired qualities in a a great leader, but how much more of all of these ingredients that I listed was required to be added this time? I'm sure there has to be, the requirement has gone up when I talk of these qualities. Yes?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I think so. The leadership has kept on evolving through times. It has been evolving in what are the new skills a leader should be having. But I think so. Most important point for today's leader is to be prepared, is how to be prepared and how to expect that you do not have help at hand and how to mobilize those resources as quick as possible. The key here is how to communicate. And where should be that communication be, and how clear that communication has to be. I think so. That's extremely important in today's time about when you're talking of leadership is quick decision making. I mean, now the decision making has to be with the evolving time. I mean, now we have already seen the phase one, phase two. Now we're looking at a phase three of the pandemic happening across the world, and it keeps changing. I mean, the scenarios day to day are changing. I'll give you an example. I mean, in phase one itself, every day we had challenges. We had challenges because the government would have to change some regulations. The government would have to do, depending on what the situation, we never understood whether we would be having a lockdown. We had to face those challenges of a lockdown. And that kind of, so every day kept on evolving. There was how would you get resources, whether medicines were getting less, how would you get those medicines, even if it was available, how would you make it available at your center, how would you dispense it to the patients, how you made it available. So soon home care started coming in. So it kept on evolving. So it was how fast, at least for the hospitals that survived this pandemic. Because a lot of hospitals went through a lot of problems because, as I said earlier, their human capital itself got compromised. Patients stopped coming to hospital. Routine care stopped. And at some point, hospitals who were surviving on a daily resource of patients coming inside, they were not able to survive because admission rates dropped in. Hospitals could not handle the pandemic because they did not have expertise within the facility. And soon they were out of business. And that further decreased the burden on the healthcare system, on also because now we have that many number of patients and less healthcare facilities. We're very fortunate, I think. So India has been extremely fortunate because the way the government of India reacted was extremely prompt and fast. We saw that the lockdown was taken in a very swift manner. Pandemic sites were built in a very swift manner. I was myself involved with building pandemic sites for BMC. For other states also. And the response was very quick. Well, one thing I would like to congratulate the Indian government on the way they have acted. I mean, and yes, we have been in constant touch with other governments also because we had a slight advantage, I would say, because we knew, okay, what happened in China and how China responded. We had some learnings and then we had some learnings out of Singapore. And then obviously we saw France was badly affected way ahead of us, France and Germany. So we were able to imbibe those learnings, but more importantly, the government acted swift and fast. We were able to increase the productivity of the medicines. A simple thing like a paracetamol was made available, and not only available for Indians, we were able to make it available for the rest of the population. Also, rest of the world, we were able to make that available. So particularly, I think so all the governments, all the state governments within India reacted promptly in setting up COVID centers. And not only that, I mean, one of the important things was changing guidelines. Guidelines kept on changing of saying, when do we do home quarantine? When do we do hospital quarantine? We had other industries such as people who could do home service or be able to produce something, a simple thing like a pulse oximeter. We were able to improve the production, increase the production, bring down the cost so that we could provide affordable care at home. So I think so this continuous process and this pandemic has been a learning experience continuously. So from a leadership point of view, I think the most important point was adaptability, extremely fast adaptability from a leader, ability to think fast and react. ability to communicate. I think so communication was has been the key, whether we had internet to communicate remotely to all your employees and to the society at large. Mm-hmm. About what should be done and how it should be done and take the preventive measures. Because the first thing obviously in any pandemic is what are the right preventive measures. Also is to stop creating the fear factor. I think so what happened was the COVID fear factor immediately arrived where people started like saying, okay, what should we do? We can't go out, groceries stopped coming inside. But the government was fast in saying, okay, online business started really blooming up. People were able to get groceries at home. So the thought process, changing that particular thought process was also kind of very important from a leadership point of view, is able to make people think and adapt fast. And also, I think, so is to have a plan and to keep using the plan and keep changing, implementing the plan and bring out the appropriate changes with the changing environment around this.
Yes, absolutely. Well said, Dr. George. And you were mentioning that everybody was affected directly or indirectly, as I believe, because one person got affected in a house, the whole house used to be quarantined. And that has not spared the medical practitioners also. And I still remember the first time a medical practitioner was no medical practitioner or talking about the medical staff or the community worker. The first instance that everybody got to know, it was a very fearful thing for the general masses that even the medical practitioners and the medicos are falling victims of the virus. So how are the medical practitioners dealing with the situations themselves? What is the biggest challenge for them? Like they being at the forefront, transmission charges and the hazards are manifold for them. So in the hospital, how are the direct medical practitioners or the medicos or the workers, how are they dealing with the situation? And how have they dealt with it in the past?
Yeah, I think so. When the pandemic broke up, it was a very difficult situation for us as medical practitioners. Let me be very honest and true about it. I mean, I'm an intensivist, so I spent all my time in the ICU. And for me, it was really, and for me, when I say me, it's my staff, my nurses in particular, who are all the time with the patient, spend all the time with the patient. So it's a more the community, like the nursing community spends around 12 hours or 8 hours, depending on the duty, directly in contact with the patient. So we as consultants or doctors used to spend much less time. So I really feel for my paramedic and nursing staff. The main issue when the pandemic broke out, it was by that time the infection had already spread into the community. So really, we didn't have ways of identifying whether a patient was COVID infectious or not COVID infectious or could be COVID infectious. So we basically had three categories of people of saying, okay, either he's COVID positive or he's COVID negative. And the quick maybe is that before a test result could come out. Now, in today's environment, obviously, it has evolved a lot. We have access to diagnostic tests, which tell us, yes, within 45 minutes or within half an hour, whether a patient has got a COVID, is going to be COVID positive or negative. But I think so when the COVID broke out, that was a big challenge. And for us as for the medical community at large, it was like we didn't know what we were dealing with. The treatment protocols kept on changing. So I think so the initial 1 or 2 months was more of a trial and error and testing for us itself. In terms of, first of all, okay, how do we protect ourselves? And secondly is, how do we protect the community? And for the doctors themselves or the nurses, for the medical staff, was how do we prevent this infection from spreading? And more importantly, how do we treat this infection? So by the time the treatment protocols came out, the 3 months really passed by where we were just struggling by saying, okay, let's use this medicine or let's use that to protect ourselves. Also, we were different prophylactics were suggested, did work. So kind of every time it was a very tricky situation even for medical practitioners. We saw on though the medical people came up front, I would be very, I mean, it's laudable. It's really laudable, especially for the nurses and the paramedics and doctors who were on the front to really come out and say, okay, let us go ahead and do it. it's like not knowing what you're dealing with and being there in the front and trying to help save lives. So, I mean, initially, yes, we lost a lot of people. A lot of, I would say, yes, we did. I mean, both in terms of patients as well as treating people, treating consultants and nurses got infected. But that is a kind of, I would say, in any pandemic, we would take that. I mean, you would take that, yes, we still had to find a cure. We still had to understand how to prevent it. But it did leave a mark on everybody in trying to adapt and how to change. Especially for a person who had to go back home. I mean, it became difficult in the initial part. I remember for the near first month, we just decided not to go home because, I mean, we were afraid we would spread the infection. But then living in that bubble, as today we all call it, is a very challenging and very difficult thing that if you have to spend, 15, 20 or 1 month just staying in the hospital, and just treating patients. I think so it becomes a very, very depressing sometimes. It did become very depressing because it was no more a kind of occasion where you could just go out and talk to somebody or have some kind of... it was a very tense environment initially.
Yes. Very rightly said, sir. The situation has been entirely different and... you also happen to have an exceptional work record in case of disaster management, managing global emergencies and pandemic preparedness already. And how has been the, like you were already mentioning about it, that if you could just a little elaborate further, that how has been the support from the authorities, the resources, the provisions, the essential provisions, or the medical kits, the PPEs, and basically the support from the society at large, if I were to ask you, how has the decision-making at your end been affected in such situations, considering the support you got? How was it?
I think so. It's extremely laudable. I think so. It's everybody came as one. I mean, that is something which was a key differentiator. What I look at it, I mean, the complete society became one where they said, okay, there was a lot of pooling in of resources. I know of communities where if somebody didn't have food to eat, they were giving food. Whether it was the authorities providing food or societies providing food. I mean, people just came out. I mean, people just came out. And that is extremely laudable. I mean, when you see, thankfully the government allowed, I mean, we were allowed to really go from, go to a hospital, and while we were traveling, we could see how people were coming out with food, water, giving it to the police people who were outside patrolling during the curfew time, or distributing it within the community so that people had food to eat. And that's something very basic, but I mean, the community just stood by each other. So I think so. That is something that we have to be very cautious about. It was a very lonely time, as we all know. We were confined in our houses, or we were confined in our workplaces. We could not go out. But the communication was there. I mean, I think so. The internet services, the services that other people provided, like people were able to watch on television, they were able to communicate with each other. So there was some sort of communication. You see, the communication channels didn't stop. What also started improving was from as consultants or as doctors, we were able to talk to our patient. So phone consultations increased. And immediately various helplines were launched by the authorities for say, treating something like a mental illness such as depression, loneliness, anything that was affecting you, so you could speak. So I think so it's laudable by the various authorities in branching out and saying, okay, we are looking at now at a holistic care. Care if a patient needs. So NGOs came out and were helping in doing online consultations. Hospitals came out in doing that. They have various factories, pharmacy factories, they started producing medicines overnight. So kind of PP kids. I mean, we never had that many PP kids at the initial part. We really never knew what was much. We didn't know much about PP kids. Yeah. But the government was so fast in preparing all this. I think so. I mean, it hardly took around 10 to 15 days. Where from our knowledge of saying we don't know about it, we made the PP kits and it was ready for use. And we kept on improvising it in such a way that it became extremely cost effective. I mean, and we were at one point we were able to export it out to the rest of the world. So I think so, as I said earlier, the promptness of the authorities in thinking about not really about care at, in the hospitals, building new centers, being able to help the people to commute to those particular centers, get the appropriate treatment. People didn't have to spend money for the particular treatment during that time. And also look after different health issues that could arise because of, say, mental health or because of want of certain drugs or certain sort of food that was also provided. So I think so, channels worked very fast and in sync with each other, and that really helped helped all the people in a very difficult time during this particular pandemic.
Absolutely. As you said all this, I am reminded of the time when even I am sitting across abroad in a third country. I'm not in India at present, and I've seen the efforts put in by the government of India back home and the authorities and the people at the senior positions. They like, even if it is Vande Bharat mission flights, the repatriation flight through Vande Bharat mission, which has just come up as a friendly gesture from the from my home back home, and we're receiving the vaccines in such a short span of time, and vaccination drives are going on. So, and even in our own societies, and like again in a third country, I could say that the Indian community has come together. The women, the families have come together, and depending on their pockets, out of their budget also, at times they've gone out of the way to distribute food packets, like you were saying, the kids and whosoever could help. People lost their jobs. They were helping them to take a flight, go back home for good. And those kind of things we have seen. So yes, you're right when you say that community support has been it's been really, really laudable. Thank you for bringing that up.
Yeah. Dr. Preeti, I think so one thing which really stood out was the humanity and the compassion that people started having. I mean, what happened was the COVID affected everybody. It was just not one household that was affected.
Yes.
And then I think so people did a lot of retrospective thinking. Earlier, what was happening is that we never used to spend time with families, with our own family. We never had time for anything. We always either busy work or with our computers or with our phones. But what happened in the COVID was a lot of retrospective thinking, because here you started really spending time with your children, with your wife, at home. Yes, and what you were going through was what everybody was going through. So it was not different. It was not really different. Yes, the scale could have been different if you're rich or poor. But from a standpoint of view, even if you were very rich, you were still isolated in your house. So
yes,
kind of everybody really had the same feelings. But one thing good was that people really came out and started helping each other and saying, okay, this is what. And that brought about a good part about it. Like, as we know, when laborers were stuck, people came out and gave money, and were looking after the food. Some took care of their transport. Some took care of, okay, whatever you need, we'll try and help you. So this was really, really helpful.
Absolutely. Very rightly said. That brings me back some memories of the last year when I myself was stuck in India during this lockdown period, and seen a lot of efforts being done by everybody together. And yes, it has not spared anyone. It was the only solution was isolation. So yes, and Dr. George, you were talking about the BCP just a while ago. That's called business continuity planning, which I did some research on this. Like the other day, we were talking about it when we conversed on this issue earlier. BCP, as per my understanding, is essentially the process that an organization undergoes to create a prevention and recovery system from potential threats, such as the natural disasters in this case. And it is basically designed to protect the personnel, make sure that they function quickly when disaster strikes. In medical terms, what is your take on this approach? You were mentioning about it earlier also. Like example, you were mentioning that example of hospitals having that exits, separate exits for COVID and non-COVID patients. So a little more elaboration on this point.
Yeah, I think so. This particular pandemic has really changed the perspective of how hospitals are going to be built in the future also. So it's right going to be from business planning, right? How, so it's going to go back, right, from planning how to build a hospital. So earlier, how hospitals were built was, if you look at some of the very old hospitals who are above 50 years old, they were just a single building unit from a nursing home. It just kept on expanding. It was not necessary the right structure to say, okay, can we have a place which is where infectious patients could be kept? And can we have a place where non-infectious patients could be kept? Most hospitals, even if we had an infectious, so we would have a very, maybe one or two rooms or three rooms where we could just keep infectious patients and say, okay, we could keep them, and certain pressure changes in the room itself. So we were not really prepared for having such a big load of infectious patients. So I'll give you a very small example. It is just a designing of a hospital, whether you have separate entrances and exits for infectious patients. Do you have separate AHUs? So is your air conditioning the same throughout the hospital? Can you change it in such a way that, I mean, the air conditioning does not, the air changes are different in an infectious unit and different in a non-infectious unit. Mm-hmm. How do you prevent, start sending goods to an infectious unit and a non-infectious unit? How do you take out goods from an infectious non? Because all that has to be really taken into account when you're thinking about, okay, how do I deal with patients? Because let us be very open and frank. When the pandemic struck us, and even during this time of the pandemic, we still have patients coming in with heart attacks, strokes, and other medical problems. And as you know, India is the diabetic capital of the world. So yes, diabetes doesn't stop, hypertension doesn't stop. So still, whatever complications of these, we still have to deal with it. So hospitals were challenged at that moment of time, really, about how to deal with it. There was a fear factor among patients themselves, because once a hospital got labeled as a contaminated zone by the authorities, or by saying it's a COVID hospital, people started fearing and just moving away from the hospital. So, I mean, it became a very challenging position for hospitals themselves. And again, as I said, if the hospital was quick to adapt, and if the hospitals in a particular locality, worked together in saying, okay, maybe I do not have the capability of either dealing with both sides of patients, means COVID and non-COVID. I would be able to make my hospital COVID. I make another hospital non-COVID. You know, I mean, I think so. If a neighborhood could just collaborate, and all the healthcare, private and government health collaboration increased a lot, that would really have impacted things faster. But the good learning was that the government started inviting private partnerships and the private discussions early. So those are a fairly good collaboration between the private and government organizations. These sort of talks were not happening before, because we were all quite of immune. We were very happy with our setups before the COVID. Everything was very good. Really, we didn't need the government setup to help us, or government didn't need us to help us. But I think the COVID has brought this collaboration between the government and private sectors.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Very rightly said. And the pandemic has given us a lot of uncertain situations. Again, we were talking about this earlier also. Things have changed every now and then. Like you've been saying that, it has been always evolving. The situation has been always evolving, and it has affected everyone with a lot of firings, layoffs, and especially the reduced salaries along with the reduced workforce at work front. How has it been to manage your teams in such a scenario? How to manage a team as a from the leader's point of view? And how have you in particular, like how have you been able to keep your team motivated to fight the battle on behalf of all of us, in fact?
I think so. I mean, Preeti, the key here for me was communicating. I mean, right from the time the pandemic broke out, yes, through the different accreditations such as JCI, ONABH, we had preparations of how to deal with pandemic, or we had some sort of pandemic plan. Though I would say that this time those plans were all kind of really tested, and really we did find a number of loopholes in those plans, because we never expected the pandemic to be at such a large scale, affecting everybody and everything else. Where we could not pool in resources from other states or other countries. So that was some part of the pandemic plan that we were not really prepared for. But yes, from a leadership point of view, what I had done was is constant communication to my employees so that they know the truth, they know where the organization is heading, what the organization will be doing, so that they could plan for whatever we would be executing. I think that was the key to communication. I mean, one of the communications that we made it as a board, we really said that nobody will get laid off. Because I think so one of the threat for what was happening was that, do I get laid off? Do I lose my job? And I think so once we were able to mitigate that threat, yes, we all took salary cuts, senior management took the biggest cuts, and it was explained to the junior management that how much cuts we were taking. So it was not that, it was not. I think so the key was your communication and transparency. I mean, as a CEO, I came to work every day. I was in the hospital. I was there with the frontline people. And so that also demonstrated the commitment of the management that, yes, we are here standing by you. We're not somebody who's giving some orders at sitting in a safe zone somewhere else. We were on frontline, because I think so it's important from a leadership point of view to demonstrate that sincerity, that honesty, their empathy, that yes, we know what is going on. We are part of this particular team, and demonstrating that we are a part of the team. Also was a quick response if any of our employees felt sick or if their families felt sick. We immediately responded to that. And I think so people took that much more seriously, where as a company, we were able to really say, yeah, hold on, we are here to protect you and your family. So we are here to care for you. And that has gone a long way for us, where people became more committed to us. Where people said, okay, we want to stand by you, because yes, we see the senior leadership down with us. We are as dirty as theirs. We are doing the same thing as them, because again, as you know, the labor got compromised. I mean, I spend more time working as a doctor than as an administrator. So that way we said, okay, we as administrators start working as doctors and doing all the work that others were there. We needed more hands on. So that was where the attitude started changing. And also, I think so what was important was giving confidence to the workforce that whatever impact will happen, it happens to the complete company. It is not an impact that will just affect you and your family. It is going to be a part of us. So we had much more bonding. We got to know people much better because we were spending more time with them. And it was, I think so, a lot of unity. I mean, earlier what was happening was the nurses were not so freely communicating with doctors. As you know, in India, there was a kind of a structure, doctors, consultants, and nurses, and paramedics. And so that all broke, those barriers broke during this time, because, I mean, we know we worked as nurses. We were putting our hand everywhere else. I mean, we just started working much more closely together. And once we had a better understanding of them, we had the same canteen food, we had everything was same. So I think so we all came together, it built much a much better bond.
And as the medical professionals also started getting affected, the workforce must have started getting reduced day by day. I mean, losing on to the working hands with you, even if the nurses, even if the community workers or the helpers or the sanitation workers, slowly the counting was getting reduced, I'm sure. At least for 15, 20 days, everybody was getting blocked out. So working with
I think so. Initially, what happened was, particularly when we had our nurses who were staying, or we had people, medical people who were staying in communities outside the hostels, which were dedicated to hospitals, they faced a lot of challenge because initially the community was not accepting them back into that particular household, saying that, okay, you're bringing infection in. But it was thanks to the government, thanks to the authorities, where a lot of communication started happening. where soon from a place of where people, medical professionals were not being accepted back home, it became a change of scenario where when a medical professional came back home, people started honking or people started saying thank you. People started kind of literally putting garlands around them. So I think so it was a change. I accept the fact that initially, yes, anybody, I mean, even if I was a non-medical profession, I think so I would have behaved in a different way of saying, okay, is this person bringing infection? Because, you know, we didn't know about the COVID. We didn't know much about it. But thanks to the authorities, thanks to the communication that we were getting on TV, thanks to the medical experts that came out and spoke boldly about it. I give a very small example. I think so. India was very fast. We brought out the vaccination campaign. And initially, there was kind of a lot of people saying, oh, should I take the vaccine or not? And what we did was that we saw top officials within the authorities or within hospitals taking the vaccine themselves. So that fright of the vaccine is actually different. I think so slowly dwindled. And today we have a huge acceptance about it. And we know more and more people are trying to understand, yes, vaccination is the only way. I mean, other than obviously personal hygiene and the personal distances that we need to maintain. That's the only way we can stop the spread of the COVID. So I think so it was a learning experience. And as learning as in any field, in any experience, as the learning becomes better, things start improving. So that's exactly the journey of the COVID.
Yes, communication has been the key, informing them at every step and every stage and making them aware. And I'll take this point a little more deeper when I'll just now what you said, that it's about the way we relate to one another. There have been cases, like you said, that we've heard so many medical professionals, young doctors, interns, even the medical students who, after returning from home, let's say, working for a straight shift, 7 to 8 days, like maybe even up to going up to 15 days in a row. Even the cases of a female staff, like me, the nurses or the female doctors or the lady doctors, carrying a life inside of them, nearing term of pregnancy. I've seen myself such ladies standing strong, doing the rounds, attending to the diseased. And they are being welcomed by the residents of the housing societies with the our shower and petal showers or bouquet, like you said, honking. With such heartwarming scenes we've all seen, which definitely make us proud, make their families proud. On the other hand, we still have seen cases where sadly, or I should say rather unfortunately, the medicals or the staff members have been forced to vacate their houses and their societies and their homes. Even their family members have been times mistreated. What is your take on that? How have we gone that far? Very unfortunate.
Yeah, unfortunately that happened. But what we did was we were able to book hotels, because at that time the travel industry just closed down. We were able to book hotels and relocate people and their families into hotels. But that was a very unfortunate situation. I mean, there, because the morale initially, as you know, when we as medical persons didn't know what we were dealing with, we were facing our own challenges from a medical point of view. And added to that, these personal challenges, they were very troublesome, because as you know, we have to strike in any profession, we have to strike a very good work-life balance, and we were not able to do that because we were worried what, suppose we were doing a 15-hour shift ourselves, we were worried whether our families were safe at home, and as you would know, we would be putting on this long gown, the PPE kit, and we were not supposed to carry phones, so many times we were at lack of communication, so we would be communicating with our family after a 12-hour shift. We would just sleep for a couple of hours and go back into the hospital, and while in our PPE kit we never spoke, because obviously we were having a double mask, we were having the complete headgear. We could not speak on phones. So it took a toll a lot, especially when we started hearing the news that people or families of medical people were getting affected. They were being questioned, people who were going home. But luckily for us, we had another set of community with us who were ready to open the hotels for us. They never in charge us, many of the people in charge us. There were land available where we could just build tents and house people. So, as I said, I could understand the fright. There was, because again, it's lack of communication, lack of trust factor, or lack of transparency that made people behave that way. It was very nice that that particular attitude changed fast, because it would have taken a lot of toll on the medical people where they would have just refused to come to work, because at the end of the day, who we work for? We work for our families. I mean, let's come down to that. I mean, that's the crux of anybody going to work for that matter, be it a medical or non-medical person. But luckily, I think so, the scenario changed quickly. We got a lot of help from the authorities, where the local police station started helping us. The local communities then started changing their view. And from a kind of a situation where we were not welcomed, it soon changed to a situation where if we started getting welcomed. And I think so, it gave a lot of boost to the people who were going back to hospitals. They were saying, okay, wow, we felt that, yes, we were being honored. Our families were being more respected. And I think so, in the eyes of everybody, today a medical professional is looked at kind of, at least they're saying, yes, thank you for helping us during this particular time.
Yes. Absolutely. But and talking about
everybody came together. It is like, I would not really say, I mean, look at the people who were delivering the goods. Yes. They also came. I mean, during the COVID time, just the delivery boy, whether he was doing from Zomato or from food delivery to anybody. So they were out. They were out there delivering whatever people wanted and needed. So I think so, hats off to everybody, I mean, for being calm, for being patient, for having that sense of empathy and sympathy. This is the first time, really, I mean, I've seen a whole nation coming together. So it's been, and the whole world coming together when we see this. I mean, today we all are talking the same language, whether it is a person in France, whether it's a person in England, whether it's a person in the US, or it's a person in Zimbabwe. So, I mean, I'm just saying that today we have doctor conferences across the globe. I think so, it's no more whether you are from which country anymore. It's like, yes, we all have dealt with it. We have all lived the same experience. And the experiences have been the same. I mean, I was speaking to my my friend in Cleveland, and he just told me the same experience. I mean, it was nothing that, yes, we might say, okay, Cleveland is different, or a hospital in India is different. It was the same experience everybody went through, whether you were a father, mother, a child, or whether you were from whatever profession you belonged to.
Yes, absolutely. And he does not mention that you had taken up the role of being more of a clinician, more than an administrator, working for 15-16 hours a day. I'm sure there was that fear factor in your mind also. So how has Dr. George dealt with that fear? Like, there's always a probability, strong chances of carrying the deadly virus back home and inadvertently or maybe unintentionally transmitting it to your beloved family members as well. So how did you personally cope up with this fear?
Kind of, I've been dealing with this for nearly 15 to 18 years. I've been working in bomb blast situations. I've been working in cross gunfire. I am a more adrenalist person. But yes, there was always that fear, because it's a different thing when you alone are in danger and you try and deal with it differently. But when you know your family is in danger, I think so, it puts in more of a fear factor in you than when you know you as an individual are in danger. So yes, I would say that it was a very difficult time, because here I felt my family was threatened more than myself, to be honest, because the COVID, from my point of view, is that all of us are carriers at some point or another. If you are unfortunately exposed to a person whom you're speaking to and you do not know whether he's COVID positive or negative, and God forbid if he's a positive person, you are likely to get it if you are within a certain meters speaking with him, if the infection gets transmitted. So the fear factor was more for my family. Yes, there was a lot of fear factor on our side, whether we're going to carry the infection home. So it was like a lot of changing of clothes or transition between the hospital and going home. And even at home, you again protect yourself. And then you stay, try and stay away from your family in a different room. There was a lot of things that we were doing, because at one point, as I said, in the initial part, we really didn't have any idea about how fast this transmission is going to happen, what is going to happen, and how to protect ourselves. So, yes, there was that kind of fear factor about whether we would transmit the infection to our family, or more importantly, would our families get infected, and how would we deal with them at that situation. So, because hospitals were already getting full, it was a very scary situation the first few days. And then thankfully, now the situation is much better.
Yeah, and you just now said about the personal well-being was taken care of, you know, taking a bath or maybe changing the clothes, the transition period, changing and rechanging. What about the mental health aspect, especially the co-workers? Like you said, one of the main important ingredients you elaborated upon was the communication. Apart from that, anything else which helped in, you know, managing the aspect of mental health, especially with your co-workers?
Yes, I think so. That was something which we immediately took up as our primary goal, because mental health is now, as you know, has become a major topic. Not only among co-workers, among families and individuals, because there was a time and there's still a time now during the lockdown, like for some parts of Maharashtra, we're still in lockdown. There's still a time where you get isolated and you don't have that human touch or human communication. You're not able to talk to somebody as you were able to talk to earlier. So I think so the first few months have been very stressful, to be honest. The people lost jobs. People, even in the healthcare industry, we saw, because many hospitals, as I said, who could not cope up with the COVID, had to close down. They just had to close down. They didn't have the resources to function further, and it particularly affected private institutions or private nursing homes, small hospitals, which didn't have those resources to kind of work for the next day because they didn't earn that enough. So a lot of people did lose jobs, and also people found it very difficult really to sustain themselves. So a topic of this mental health, about how to really deal with it. One thing that we did was we had a communication with all our staff on a daily basis, telling them about what we're doing, what we're planning, what's happening in the community. We were able to also keep food for them which they could take back to their families. So from a hospital point of view, we were able to kind of manage, because obviously the first thing is how are you going to look after your family. So more than money that there was needed, I think so it was more that, okay, yeah, we were able to give them basic amenities of food, which they could go back home and distribute among the family members, and also have that daily talk where the fear factor could be removed. I don't think so we could really remove the fear factor totally, but at least we could mitigate as many risks or as many fears as possible. And we kept a constant communication channel. So that was very important from our point of view, was to talk to them and see that they are at a particular comfort level, because it was very easy, to be honest, though we are medical professionals, we are still all human beings. We all, at some point, would have a breakdown, because it could be a very simple thing like a breakdown. You lose a patient. I'll tell you an incident which I had in Afghanistan. We went in with around 40 people as doctors, nurses, paramedics. One of the British clinics had got bombarded, and we went to kind of save lives. And it was a very difficult situation at that moment of time, where when we came back, a number of people just could not deal with that particular disaster that they went through. And they just said, we cannot be medical professionals anymore. So it impacted people to such an extent that they just gave up being doctors or nurses or paramedics, because it left an impression. Similarly, this particular pandemic, for many people who have been on the front line, it has been quite traumatic, to be honest, when they, first of all, they had to deal with maybe not being able to save a life, or they had to deal with just the isolation, just that kind of being in a PPE kit for 8 hours and then going back, came back to work and not knowing how to deal with certain failures that you would have in a medical profession, because at that moment we did not know whether we were doing the right thing. So it was quite traumatic, and I think so what really was helped was the community and the people just coming together, talking about it. It's important that we just talk about what is inside and what we never used to do. I'll be very open. We never used to talk about what was going in our heads, going in our minds and in our heart. Today, I find that we encourage people to start communicating, tell us what's going on. Suddenly, we would find a person going into a shell. We would really go and see that we communicate with him for a long period of time so that he or she would open up and talk about it. So, again, I think so. It's very important. Though today we have technology at hand, the human touch or the presence of a human being or the human voice itself is extremely important just to calm a person and just to, for a person to come back to normal in this particular scenario.
Absolutely, Dr. George. It's equally traumatic for a medical professional also to lose a life. It's just the worst that could happen. It's just not the family members or the affected parties. It's it actually affects the mental health of the practitioner as well. And yes, now I'll take the conversation towards, not towards the patients and not towards the medical practitioners. We'll talk about as masses, as citizens, with the higher level of awareness owing to a lot of information portals, social media handles, WhatsApp University, and a lot of gyan coming up from all the sources. What should be the role of public or the role of citizens? Individual, if I were to talk about me, like me being a medico, I still understand certain things, but if I weren't a medico also, then also it becomes my responsibility and duty that I vet the information which is coming to me, I scan for its authenticity, I check whether it is reliable only from the trusted source, and then only I disseminate that information, even if it is about COVID or non-COVID also. Also, another thing that I realized, that learning to do a CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation that we call, in emergency cases, it should come very handy to everyone. We just learn it like on a dummy and then just forget it. But it's actually, I think it must have come very handy to the people who knew it. And basically, as an individual, what should be the role of the society, the role of the citizens, like not adding to the already worsened situation, learning a CPR or not, I mean, vetting the information and all. So what are your suggestions that as a citizen or as a responsible citizen of the society, we should do in such situations?
Yes, I think so. One thing that is very important, as you rightly mentioned, is trying to ensure that you get the information from the right source and not listening to rumors. I mean, it is a kind of a sad that at some point, there was so much of information, so much of rumors, and there was kind of, because we lived in this technology world, we were more relying on technology and whatever information was coming up, not trying to name WhatsApps, groups that were formed, or WhatsApp informations that were given, or Google doctors that technology became. But it was important, it is a very important event today, in today's scenario, that we get authentic information. We rely on what the authority, whether it is the state government or the central government, is saying, what is the current situation, as per what are the guidelines, and also from medical experts. It's very important. I mean, today, when I would listen to an infectious disease expert of authority who is going to be talking about it, say WHO, or from the Indian government, somebody who has the authority of what is going on the ground level and is explaining that particular situation of how to deal with it. Simple thing, like, okay, checking your temperature, checking if you have, your oxygen saturation is right. I mean, not rushing into an hospital and saying, okay, I have got COVID, or getting that fear factor, bukhar aa gaya, or something has happened, and I have got self-diagnosing yourself or self-treating yourself. Very important. And also is to really, as I said, is government has laid certain guidelines of saying, unless your temperature is not this much, or unless your oxygen saturation does not fall to a certain level, you may not come to the hospital, even if you're COVID positive. So, I mean, I think it's very important, because it's not only that you're compromising the existing resources, but more importantly, I feel, you're putting your own life and your family's life in danger. Simple things like saying, okay, everything is now, there's a curfew. Please stick to it. I mean, it is a curfew. There's nothing else you can do. Your best time to spend at home, spend it with your family. Try to make every moment as productive, as interesting, because these times never came before. I mean, God forbid, it will never happen.
Yes,
I mean, so there was kind of things where you could really self-retrospect and look into yourself and look into, okay, what is the plan? Spend some time with your quality time with your children or within the society that you live in. So those were important things. Now, as you rightly said, simple things like learning your hand wash techniques, keeping a distance when you're talking to somebody, so that, okay, you know, okay, you're not going to have, keeping your conversations with them at the shortest level, because the amount of transmission time is decreased. How to hand wash, how to, when you're touching some unknown objects, how to again sanitize, simple things like CPR. Again, as I said, these are learnings that we should be able to do. Today, though vaccination is out, but still, as we said, the vaccine efficacy is X amount. But importantly, your hand hygiene, your sanitation, again, I think so it goes back to your basics.
Basics.
Your basics of saying, okay, I will keep my hands clean. I will not see that I touch it to my mouth. I will not expose myself to infection. I will use, whenever I go out, I have covered my mouth with a mask. So, I mean, those are the important things. When I'm communicating, maybe for buying bread, seeing I keep a distance from the shopkeeper, and keeping my communication as short as possible, so that my, even if he's infected, I am not getting the infection.
Right. Absolutely. This time, I believe, Dr. George, technology has come to our rescue, be it a Zoom meeting, be it a WhatsApp call or a video call. We have been able to connect with the loved ones across the sea, across the borders. Many of us became painters. Many of us became writers. We had good quality time with the parents. We had time with the spouses, which was much needed. I guess it was quite needed. So this time technology has come to the rescue, I'm sure. But as compared to the previous times I'm talking of, like the disasters previously happened, how do you think we stay prepared for such scenarios in future? God forbid, like you said, if it just in case arises once again. What is the preparedness?
So I think so. I'll just give you an example. Before pandemic came, I mean, and we used to do a lot of telehealth, especially since I come from being exposed to remote areas, I used to be a big propagator of telehealth, but I had no bias. Nobody wanted to really say, they still felt, I want to go to the hospital, I want to meet the doctor. So really, telemedicine was not selling. Remote home monitoring was not selling. But now the scenario has totally changed because of technology. I have more patients who will say, okay, doctor, I've seen you once. From now on, I'm going to communicate with you through a telecall. So kind of communication has changed. More and more people are now investing in home devices where your BP is monitored at home, or your EKG or ECG can be done, and it can be communicated to your doctor. Suppose you're a patient of heart failure or a heart patient. So I think so. Technology has changed the complete scenario, and I also feel the future of healthcare is going to be totally different than what it used to be maybe 1 year ago. The more of the OPDs are going to be more outpatient, online OPDs, and that's really good, because what I feel is that hospitals should be doing serious work. more ICUs, more kind of intensive care, more operations, more kind of serious work can be done in hospitals. And I think so moving out the kind of things such as I said, consultation, they move out. People will start now focusing more on wellness programs, and inculcating that into the daily life, because at the end of the day, what has saved a lot of people, it's their immunity. From either immunity of getting the disease or being able to sustain themselves through this tough time. Whether you say it's your mental health or your physical health, I think so that's now come into a big play. And from a technology point of view, there's been a lot of investment in this, where today you have yoga classes on technology, you have mental health classes going on technology. People are today ready to invest that time of theirs and say, yes, I think so, I want to be more open about my body, I want to learn more about it, I want to keep myself safe. Now I see a lot more people investing them. There's more kind of more preventive health checkups going on, where you have some person going home doing the blood test, and the test results are now available on your phone, and you are in more constant communication with your doctor on the phone, saying, okay, because maybe my LFTs are raised, liver function tests are raised, or kidney function, what should I do to improve it? What are the exercises that I can do at home so as to keep myself healthy and safe? So I think so in terms of technology has really changed the scenario, as I said, from what we had 1 year ago to now today. It's totally now technology driven and adaptability. I think so earlier we had a lot of complaints from people who are above 50 saying, I don't want to use this. This is something that I don't like to adapt to. Today you have everybody. I mean, my mother says she's 78, 80, and now she is extremely and I think so 1 year ago, she just used to hand me the phone and say, you do it for me. And now she does it. So it's kind of, you can see the change in attitude and change in behavior.
Absolutely. The learning at the higher age groups has been incredible, in fact. The parents, the grandparents are now, you know, they don't need us. My young kiddo, he's hardly eight and a half. Doesn't need me anymore. I mean, the younger age groups and the older age groups have learned much better. The use of technology, and they're connected amongst themselves. So that's one of the very good things which has happened because of this COVID. And now I'll move to the last question for the session. Dr. George, this is for you. Do you believe in miracles? Like, with no signs of vaccine a few months back, we have a full-fledged vaccination drive going on in many parts of the world as we speak right now. And we have started recovering in our fight against the virus. Like in two to three months, there has been tremendous improvement. So is it a miracle? Is it hope? And what are your concluding remarks to this scenario?
Dr. Preeti, I can only say, wow, this is amazing. I mean, we all know a vaccine takes at least 7 to 10 years. There are a number of trials that goes on. It's a miracle. It's a miracle to all the people who have been working behind the scene, the people who have been the scientists, the biologists, the pharmacists. It's everybody. I think so. It's everybody. Everybody have done their bit. I mean, they have. Their work might not be seen or felt, but now when the vaccine has come out, we need to really go and thank them and appreciate them. There have been numerous, there have been millions of people who have worked, who have done maybe more sacrifices than all of us who have been sitting here, or all of us doctors, I might say, who have done a lot of work. I mean, it has been, as I said, the whole community. When you say, do I believe in miracles? Yes. As a doctor, I have to believe in miracles, because I mean, we still depend on God to save lives. We are just doctors. We are just people who have learned medicine and try to do it. I just like to say a joke. I was speaking to a neurosurgeon and asking him why his success rate is so good. He says, George, I just look at the person's palm and look at his lifeline, and then I take him off for surgery. So kind of we all still believe in miracles, saying, and we have to. I mean, this vaccination drive has been tremendous. Just see the number of vaccines that we have available. We were exporting these vaccines. We always started exporting the vaccines. And I mean, we now have states who are saying that we will be doing 40 lakh people per day. They will be inoculating, vaccinating 40 lakh per day. Mm-hmm. And I mean, this is a tremendous effort.
It's a huge number,
first of all, to produce, first of all, to be able to make this vaccine available.
Make the vaccine.
You just think about it. I mean, 10 years, a normal vaccine comes out after 10 years. And here we have vaccine companies who have come out. Yes. And today we have both the Covishield, Covaxin in India, and people are taking it comfortable. And I think so. We are looking for that particular herd immunity. Or we are looking at that in terms of efficacy. We already have saying it's 72% to 78% efficacy is there. And my last would be, do not shy away from taking the vaccine. It's extremely important. Vaccine will help to prevent. Yes, some people have side effects, but the side effects are with every vaccine. Your child would have taken a DPT and shot and would have got fever. So it's a normal thing. So come on. So we give it to our children. And why are we afraid to take it? So come on, let's grow up.
Yes, absolutely. Very, very, very rightly said, Dr. George. Thank you so, so much for such a heartwarming and insightful session on leading with resilience, teamwork, and managing the crisis, hoping the viewers got some insight on how the warriors are dealing with the crisis on a day-to-day basis, actually. And they have been there to fight. They have been there for us. Needless to say, they are humans. They have emotions. They have needs. And they certainly have issues. And as I close the session and say goodbye to all of you, I am reminded of a saying by the great Rumi. Being a candle is not easy. In order to light others, you must first burn yourself up. Our warriors have been the candles in our lives who are burning themselves day and night to lighten up our lives and create beautiful stories in the end. Shukran, and thank you so much everyone for watching the show. Have a good night and a great life ahead. Stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.